Hi, you guys. Happy Tuesday. Okay. So I am going to dive right in. I have been working on a series of messages called Restoration of Hope. But the first message is actually called Revelation of Hope, which I'm going to share with you guys today. I'm hoping that I'll be able to get it all out of me in one session. I don't know if I will or not. But I gave you guys an introduction about a week ago, and I gave you guys an introduction to my introduction about 2 weeks ago. So I just want to say hi. This is Dawn Churchill. Do me a favor, like, love, and share this video on your timeline. I know that I'll be posting this on other social media platforms later, so do me a favor, follow me on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, LinkedIn, anywhere else. And if you would like to hear all of the messages that I have shared previous to this, make sure that you go to my YouTube channel. In fact, I have included it as one of the links in the description of this video, okay? And so I think that's it. Yeah, subscribe to my YouTube channel. All right, so I'm gonna dive in today. I feel like a disorganized preacher. I have like notebooks and Bibles all over the place in front of me. So I'm praying that God will enable me to align all of my thoughts in the right direction. So I'm gonna pray first, and then I'm just gonna go ahead and get started. So, Father God, we come to you in Jesus' name and we praise you and we thank you for this day. Lord, I thank you for the word of God, which is alive and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, that brings life and healing and hope to everyone who hear it. Father God, I pray that everyone under the sound of my voice right now and those that will watch the replay in the future, Father God, that you would bring revelation and peace and joy and hope to each one of their lives, and that through your words that are released through my mouth, Father God, that you will bring to pass, Father God, your perfect will in the lives of each and every person. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, y'all. All right, so I am going to do just this much recap, not a lot. I'm going to do a little bit of recap. But anyway, so this kind of started because I had a conversation with one of my girlfriends, probably a couple of months ago. And she said to me, and she's a Christian, and she said, "Dawn," she goes, "I don't even know what hope looks like anymore." And I was so grieved in my spirit because I thought, how can somebody who knows God and has walked with him for so long not even know what hope looks like anymore? And so the first thing I want to say to you, and I'll explain it a little while later, is hope looks like yes. Hope sounds like yes. And I'm going to clarify that statement later on, okay? And so it grieved my spirit so much that the Lord just began to speak to me. From the place of people that walk in a consistent, kind of like an ongoing existence of a lack of peace, a lack of provision, a lack of protection, but more than anything, a lack of joy and hope in their lives. And I don't believe that that is God's will for us. Okay, so I'm going to recap by starting with Isaiah chapter 32, verse 18. And I'm actually going to turn there in my Bible. So my favorite Bible, which has been falling apart for years and years and years, is actually an NIV version, but I won't get rid of it, even though it is literally falling apart at the seams, because all my favorite notes are written in it. And it was the Bible that I got when I was first saved. Well, no wonder it's fallen apart. I've been saved for almost 30 years now. Okay. All right. So here we go. Isaiah 32, verse 18, which says, "My people will live in peaceful dwelling places, in secure homes, in undisturbed places of rest. So that's the first thing that I want to share with you, is that you are supposed to be in a continual state. I don't necessarily just mean your physical home. I mean your habitation, your dwelling place. And what I mean by that is, I mean the existence, the energy field that you live in is supposed to be a consistent place of peace, a place of undisturbed rest. That is God's will for your life, every moment of every day. And if you are living and walking in the fullness of the presence of God, then you will be in that place of undisturbed rest, no matter what situations look like around you. Okay, so that's the first scripture that I want to remind you guys of. Okay, the next one, struggling with these goofy glasses, is John 16, verses 23 through 24. And I'm going to read that to you. It says, "My Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. Until now, you've not asked me for anything." By the way, this was Jesus talking. He says, "But ask and you shall receive, and your joy will be complete." And whenever I read that, I always think, ask and keep asking and keep asking. And the reason I say that is because the heart of the Father is always has a yes towards us. And I'm going to expound on that a little bit later. Now, God knows what we need, when we need it, how we need it. And He is the most amazing provider. He knows how to bring into our lives in the perfect season those things that we need so much. And I'm not just talking about financial or physical provisions. But I know that sometimes I think that God blesses me with certain things in my life just because I bug Him. You know, like I'm one of those little kids, like, you know, like if when my children were little, like toddlers, like 2 and 3 year olds, "Mommy, mommy, mommy, please, mommy, please, mommy, please." And sometimes I would give them what they wanted just so they would quit bugging me. But when I did so from a heart of love, because I wanted to bless them. So I want to encourage you not only to ask, but to keep asking. And God will show you just the right way for you to receive that which you're asking Him for. Okay, so the next scripture that I want to take you to, and again, I'm just doing a little bit of recap. I'm just recapping some of the scriptures that I shared in the last two messages. And that is Isaiah 26, verses 3 through 4. Now, this is one of my favorites. All right, so Isaiah chapter 26, verses 3 and 4 says, "You will keep him in perfect peace, whose eyes are stayed on you, because he trusts in you." And it says, "Trust in the Lord forever, for the Lord God is our rock eternal." So I'm going to tell you, this is one of the keys to living in that perpetual state of undisturbed rest, is that you would keep your eyes on him. The Bible says that God will keep him in perfect peace, whose eyes are stayed on him. So the minute that you start to take your eyes off of Jesus, you start to take your eyes off of the presence of God, then you can start to become overwhelmed by the things that go on around you. But it doesn't matter what the circumstances in your life, if your eyes are stayed on him, he will keep you in perfect peace. Okay, again, I'm just recapping some of the scriptures that I had shared earlier. Then I want to go to verse 19, because verse 19 I felt like literally was a prophetic word for some of you guys last week. And sorry about that. And so Isaiah chapter 26, verse 19, it says, "But your dead shall live. Their bodies will rise up. You who dwell in dust, wake up and shout for joy, for your dew will be like the dew of the morning, and the earth will give birth to her dead." And so I want to say prophetically over your guys' lives today that whatever is dormant or you feel is dead, or those areas of your life where you feel like there is deadness, there is dormancy, there is no creative juices are flowing, there's not real joy and life there, God says to you today through Isaiah chapter 16 and verse 9. I'm sorry, that's not right. Isaiah 26. See, trying to read it without my glasses on. Isaiah 26, verse 19. It says that your dead shall rise. It says, "You who dwell in dust, will rise up. And so that was one of the scriptures that I think that I shared last week. And so I want you to grab hold of that this week. All right, I'm almost done doing a recap, and then I'll actually get into what the Lord laid on my heart for you guys today. But it says that your dead will live, you who dwell in dust, you who feel like you are dwelling in dust. God says he's going to breathe new life onto you. Okay, so now, again, I'm just doing a recap. Hebrews chapter 11, one of my favorite scriptures of the Bible. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, it says, "Now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see." Okay, hold on a second. I got to grab my other notebook, and I'm going to review for you guys. I'm going to rewind for you guys what the word hope actually means in both the Old and in the New Testament. Are y'all ready for this? Okay. So I'm not going to read to you the actual Hebrew words and the actual Greek words, because I already know that my pronunciation of them is kind of not good. But I'm going to read to you. I had read several scriptures for you guys last week, and each one of them had the word hope in them. And so I'm going to give you the definition according to both the Hebrew and Greek languages, what that word means. So hope. Hope means expectation. It means confidence and trust. So it means confident expectation and trust. It also means to wait in hopeful expectation, to tarry in patient trust. It also means to anticipate with pleasure, the expectation of good or blessing. It also means joyful and confident assured or sureness. It also means to keep hopeful watch, to watch closely as a spy, to literally lean forward and to peer into the distance. So I'm going to reread Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, and I want you to put that definition into the word hope there, okay? All right, it says, "Now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see yet." Okay, so there are, let me see if I can show this to you guys. I don't know if it'll translate, because I think, it probably looks backwards. Okay, so this is one of my notebooks. All right, I have like a bunch of notebooks, like journal notebooks. This is one that I can't remember who, I was listening to a preacher, and he encouraged us to write down, like, I can't remember how many he said. He said, like, I don't know, like 500 things that we feel like we need or that we want from God. And he says, once you get to about number 70, it's going to be hard for you to kind of like keep coming up with them. So for the last couple of months, I've been writing them down in this little notebook. I've gotten to number 103 or 104. Now, in the process of writing these down, and by the way, they're not all physical things, but in the process of writing these down, at least 20 of them have been answered. In fact, you know what? I'm just going to, I do feel like I'm speaking like I'm following rabbit trails, but it's okay. All right. So for instance, one of the first things that I wrote down was things that I want or need. Number one, I wrote down lots of daily time with God for prayer, worship, and communion. Number two, an increasing awareness of his presence. Number three, creative ideas and strategies for business and ministry. So those are some non-tangible things that I ask God for. A physical thing that I asked God for was that I wanted to go home to Illinois for Christmas, and that while I was there, that I'm not even going to share with you all of those things, but anyway, and everything that I wrote down that I thought that I needed or that I wanted, God answered. And so one day God challenged me. He says, "Dawn," he goes, "I want you to take the title. It says things that I need." He says, "I want you to cross out the word need." And he says, "I want you to write in already have." So instead of things that I need, these are things that I already have, that I'm already trusting God and believing him to provide or bless in my life. And as I said, some of them are not tangible things. The very first one on my list was, hold on a second, I tried to open it up. Lots of daily time with God for prayer, worship, and communion. Okay. All right. So going back to Hebrews 11 and 1, where it says, "Now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not yet see."
One of the definitions for hope that I expounded on last week was hopeful expectation, the kind of expectation that literally leans forward and presses in and is watching and waiting and expecting God to move. And so I guess this is, I'm going to clarify what I mean by when I says hope looks like yes. The reason why I want to give you guys an expanded explanation or revelation of what hope is because if you don't know what it looks like, if you don't know what it feels like, if you don't know what it tastes like or smells like, how can you have it in your life? How can it be rejuvenated in your life? How can it be restored in your life if you don't even know what it looks like to begin with? And so what I want to tell you today is that hope looks like yes, and hope sounds like yes. And I'm going to clarify that statement in just a little while. Okay. So again, I am recapping some of the scriptures that I shared with you guys in a couple of previous messages. Micah 7:7. Now this one is always a challenge to find because Micah is one of those small prophets of the Old Testament, and it's such a small book that sometimes I end up going right past it, but God was good to me today. Here we go. Micah 7:7 says, "But as for me, I watch in hope," remember, expectation, joyful expectation, patient trust and expectation. He says, "But as for me, I watch in hope for the Lord," and I parenthetically insert "to move on my behalf." He says, "I wait for my God and my Savior. My God will hear me." So as I'm doing this review of some scriptures that I shared last week, I want to tell you right now that God hears you. I want to reaffirm to you that God sees you, God knows you, and God hears you. I'm going to say that again. God sees you, God knows you, and God hears you. Sometimes we feel like maybe God has forgotten. Maybe he doesn't really see what I'm going through right now. Maybe he doesn't really hear me like when I'm praying. Maybe he doesn't really know me the way I want to be known, but that is not true. God sees you, knows you, and hears you. Okay. All right. Again, I'm almost done with the recap. Proverbs 13:12 says, "But hope deferred makes the heart sick." Okay, so one of the balances of walking out this Christian life and walking a faith life that is full of hope and expectation is that sometimes we have an idea of what we want, how we want it, when we want to receive it. And again, I'm not just talking about physical provisions and things. I'm talking about circumstances in our life or, you know, whatever it may be. But the reality is that God's ways are higher than our ways. He knows what is best for us. He is a good, good, good Father. And the Bible says that every good and perfect gift comes from the Father of lights. Now, what's amazing is because he is such a magnanimous creature. He is so brilliant. He knows exactly when we need, what we need, how we need it. And he's smart enough to not give us the things that we think we want right now, but that we can't really handle. And so I'm going to take you to Isaiah chapter 55, and then I'm going to actually get on with my actual message today. Ha ha. Okay. All right. So Isaiah chapter 55. We're almost there. Isaiah chapter 55 and verse 10 says, "For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it to bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word, says the Lord, that goes out of my mouth. It will not return to me empty or void, but it will accomplish that which I desire, and it will achieve the purpose for which I sent it." Actually, I wanted to read to you the verses before that. Verse 9 says, "As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and are my thoughts higher than your thoughts, says the Lord." Okay, so I just want to remind you of that because God is a good, good Father. It's not that he doesn't see you. It's not that he doesn't know you. And it's not that he doesn't hear you. He knows exactly what you need, when you need it, how you need it. And he's so wonderful.
that he blesses us with exactly what we need at the right time.
Okay. All right. So that was recap or reintroduction or what have you.
All right. So what I want to share with you today is, so I believe that if we are going to have a restoration of hope in our lives, if God is going to rejuvenate that, that we first need to have a revelation of it. We need to know what it looks like. Okay. So what I want to tell you is that hope looks like yes. Are you ready? Okay. The revelation of hope, or the one that God's been, I guess, awakening in me, is that you are supposed to walk in a continuous flow of God's provision, protection, and peace at all times. I'm going to say that again. The revelation of hope that God's been sharing with me is that you are supposed to walk in a continuous flow of God's provision, protection, and peace. A revelation of hope is that there is always a yes in God's spirit towards you. I'm going to say that again. There is always, 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 always a yes in God's spirit towards you, in his heart towards you. Always. There's never a no in God's heart towards you. He always has a yes in his heart. Now, he may delay in blessing you with certain things until you're ready to manage them, until you're ready to oversee them, until you're ready to be grateful for them, until you're ready to multiply them, because his ways are higher than our ways. I just read that from Isaiah chapter 55. But there is always, always a yes in God's heart towards you. He always forgives you. I mean, he always forgives you. I know that for years as a Christian, I knew that God loved me. But, you know, like if I messed up and I don't know, I did something that I'd been struggling with before, I was so sure that I had to grovel for God's forgiveness, that I had to, like, somehow, I don't know, repent enough for it to be enough for him to forgive me. And that's not how it works. So number one, I want to tell you that he always forgives you, always. Number two, God always sees you. There's not a moment of your life that he doesn't see or doesn't know about. Even if you believe that negative self-talk in your head that says that God doesn't really see you. Yes, he does. Okay. Number three, God always hears you, because he is the one that created us in our mother's womb. Like, he knew us before we were even born. Bible says in somewhere in Psalms, I can't remember the scripture right now, but it says that before you were formed in your mother's womb, he says, I knew you. So God knows you. He actually knows you better than you know yourself. All right. So yes, he always loves you. One of the reasons why sometimes we have a hard time receiving the fullness of what God has for us is because we don't always believe that he really loves us. So many of us have been taught a legalistic, ritualistic love of God, or we've... I'm not saying that I don't believe in sloppy grace, and I don't believe that we should just live our lives however our flesh wants us to live. But the reality is that God always loves us. He always forgives us. There is always a yes in his heart towards us. He will always provide for you. Always. Now, there have been moments and seasons of my life where I lived in scant resources. However, God never allowed me to go hungry. He never allowed me to be homeless. He never allowed me to not have a place to sleep. He never allowed. So I'm just saying, he always, and when I began to really turn to him instead of my own abilities to provide for myself, I began to watch him do miracles for me that I'd never seen before. So he always provides for you, always. He always protects you, always. He is always looking to protect you from harm. Now, sometimes we get into situations that we think are good for us and we don't really check it out with him. And then we experience some pain or some trauma or some heartache that we were never meant to experience because we didn't really check out the situation with God first. But that's not on him. And what's weird is that he'll still take that situation. If you ask him to help you get out of it, He'll protect you from harm. All right. And then the last one is that he, yes, he always, it is his heart that we walk in an overflow of the peace of his presence. Okay. So the revelation of hope that I want you guys to have today, or the revelation that I want you to have today, is that there is always a yes in the heart of God the Father toward you, period. I don't care what you've done. I don't care what you think you're not able to be forgiven from. I don't care how you feel like maybe you have failed. I don't care how you might feel that you've screwed something up. I don't care how you might feel like you have wasted opportunities. I don't care what it is that you think that you have done. There's nothing that can separate you from the love of God. Nothing. There is always a yes in the heart of God towards you. So that's the first thing that I want to share with you guys today. So now I'm actually going to go to, we have three main scriptures that we're going to look at today, and they are all in Psalms. Okay. So we're going to go to two, hopefully really, familiar passages. And if they're not familiar to you, then I'm going to introduce you to them. Okay. So first of all, we're going to go to Psalm 91 in just a moment. Alrighty. If you guys could see this Bible that's like falling apart at the seams, you would probably say, Dawn, why don't you just get a new one? And I do have a bunch of them. I just like this one the best. All right. Psalm 91. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge, my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely he will save me from the fowler's snare and the deadly pestilence. He will cover me with his feathers. Under his wings, I will find refuge. His faithfulness will be my shield and rampart. I will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day. I will not fear the pestilence that stalks in darkness, nor the plague that storms at midday. 1,000 may fall at my side, 10,000 will fall at my right hand, but no evil will come near me. I will only observe with my eyes and see the punishment of the wicked. It says, if I will make the Most High my dwelling place, even the Lord who is my refuge, then no harm will befall me. It says, no disaster will come near my tent. The word says that he will command his angels concerning me, that they will lift me up in their hands so that I might not strike my foot against a stone. It says that I will tread upon the lion and the cobra. I will trample on the great lion and the serpent because he loves me, or because she loves me, says the Lord. God says, I will rescue him or her. I will protect him or her because they acknowledge my name. He says, he will call upon me and I will answer him, says the Lord. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him, and with long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Okay, so that is all of Psalm 91. So what I want to say there is, the Bible says that he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High will dwell under the covering, under the kabod, under the weighty glory of God. I'm going to say that again. It says that he who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest under the shadow of the Almighty. So the first thing I want you to know is that you are supposed to be living under this canopy of God's provision, protection, and peace. You are supposed to be living under a canopy of the kabod and weighty glory of God. You are supposed to be living under a canopy of his presence. And in his presence, there is fullness of joy. You are supposed to be resting under this covering of his peace and his life and his vitality in your life. That is what we are supposed to be experiencing, but there's only one way to experience it. And it says that he who dwells in the shelter of the Most High. So let me ask you this. Where is your habitation place? Where have you been dwelling and spending your spiritual, emotional, and mental energy? So it's not that God doesn't have enough peace and hope and love and joy to bless us with, we have to get into that place of receiving. So the Bible says that he will cover us as with his feathers, that he will literally make a shelter or a tabernacle round about us. So the thing is, that I said, there is always a yes in God's spirit towards you. In order for you to receive that, you have to know, you have to have a revelation of how much he loves you. You have to know that every time you come to him, he does not push you away. That every time you come to him, that his arms are wide open. I'm going to say this only because I'm thinking of a particular person that I know that I had just had a conversation with a couple of days ago. And he said to me, he says, "You don't know some of the things that I've done. You don't know." And I said, "It doesn't matter. There is nothing that can separate us from the love of God." So we are supposed to be living under this canopy, under the weighty glory and kabod of God. The only way that we can do that is by making his dwelling place, his presence, our habitation. Okay. In one of my, one of the teachings that I do in one of my health and wellness courses, I talk about how habits are actually habitations that have taken up residence in our life. Okay, I'm going to say that again. Habits, whether they be good or bad habits, are really habitations that have taken up residence in our life. Okay. And so some of us have good habits, you know, like maybe we brush our teeth every morning, we make our bed every day. And then some of us have bad habits, you know, like, I don't know, we watch too much TV late at night and we eat too much salt. I don't know. But anyway, habits are actually habitations that have taken up residence in our life. So if you will make the habit of just coming to God every day and saying, "Lord, I'm here. Like, I don't even know how to do this prayer thing. I don't even really understand all of the words that are written in my Bible. But your word says that you will keep me in perfect peace whose eyes are stayed on you. So I'm turning my eyes to you today, God. Your word says that, that he who dwells under the shelter of the Most High will rest in peace, will rest in undisturbed calmness underneath your provision, protection, and peace, underneath the canopy of your presence. So God, here I am. I don't even know how to do this. I don't know the right way to do this. I don't know the wrong way to do this. I'm just here." And Dawn says that there's always a yes in your heart towards me, God. So I'm going to take her at her word. And so if you're feeling that lack of peace in your life, then the revelation that I want to give to you today is all you have to do is sit underneath that canopy. All right. The next thing is that sometimes it's been hard for me, even that I know that God's heart towards me is good. I know that his heart towards me is that, that I walk in the fullness of his presence every day of my life. There's been times and seasons where it's been difficult for me to receive that. And I'll tell you two or three different reasons. Number one, sometimes I struggled with believing that God really loved me. Like I thought maybe he was holding something against me from a year ago or 10 years ago or 2 days ago. Or I believed that I somehow had to earn his forgiveness or his love because there were some things I had done that just were really unpleasing to him. Or a really bad one was that I wasn't really worthy to receive his love, his joy, his peace, his protection, his kindness, because sometimes I'm just not that great of a person. I'm imperfect. And so sometimes God began to show me that I had a hard time receiving from God because I didn't believe that I was worthy or deserving of everything that his word says is already mine. And when I began to renew my mind with the word of God that says that I'm his daughter and you are his daughter or you are his son, which means that you are a daughter or a son of the Most High God. If you are a daughter or a son of the Most High God, the Bible says that you are a joint heir with Christ, that you are seated in heavenly places of honor, esteem, and glory. The Bible says that you are a joint heir with Christ, which means that you are a joint heir to everything that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, has access to. Well, he has access to the entire riches of heaven and earth. So if we are joint heirs with Christ, and we are made holy by the blood of Jesus that was shed for us, then there's no way that I can earn enough worthiness to receive from God. I literally have to receive it by faith. I literally have to receive it with joy. I literally have to receive it just knowing that my God loves me that much. Okay. All right. So I wanted to share with you Psalm 51. So now I'm going to go to Psalm 112. Y'all ready? Alrighty. All right. It says, "Blessed is the man who fears the Lord, he who finds great delights in the commands of God. His children will be mighty in the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches are in his house, and his righteousness endures forever." It says that even in darkness, the light dawns upon the upright in heart. It says that for the gracious and compassionate and righteous man, it says good will come to him who is generous and who lends freely and who conducts his affairs with justice. Surely he will never be shaken. A righteous man will be remembered forever. It says he will have no fear of bad news. His heart is steadfast, trusting in the Lord. His heart is secure. He will have no fear whatsoever. That means none, nada, nothing. it says that in the end, he will look in triumph on his foes. He has scattered abroad his gifts to the poor, and his righteousness endures forever. His horn will be lifted high in honor. The wicked man will see and be vexed. He will gnash his teeth and waste away, and the longings of the wicked will come to nothing. Okay, so Psalm 112 talks about a blessed righteous man, okay? And I was like, okay, so Lord, sometimes this scripture has haunted me a little bit. I'm like, well, maybe I'm not as blessed as I should be because I'm just not as righteous and holy as I ought to be. Because I look at this scripture and this is talking about a righteous, holy man or woman of God, right? Like it says that he is blessed, he or she is blessed, which is happy and fortunate and full of all the goodness of God, that he is blessed because he finds great delight in the law of the Lord. It says that he finds great delight in his commands. And I was like, well, maybe that's the problem. Maybe that's why I'm not as blessed as I ought to be. Because I'm just not as righteous and holy as I should be. And God reminded me, he says, baby girl, he said, you can't never, ever. See, God talks to me the way I think sometimes. You can't never, ever be as righteous and holy as you could ever want to be. You're an imperfect human being. Now, yes, we should. The longer that we walk with God, we should ascribe to a level of excellence in our life. But the reality is that I am still a flawed human being. Now, anything that is wonderful that comes out of me, the fruit of the Spirit, the love, joy, peace, gentleness, kindness, patience, long-suffering, all of that stuff that comes out of me that is a reflection of his life and light within me, that's just a blessing because he's good. You know what I mean? It's not because I've worked it up to a certain degree that I can just, you know, walk in that. So what I want to show you is that through this scripture, that all of these things that it says that a righteous man, that a blessed man will experience, that all of these are supposed to be ours. Because as we seek to walk with God, the Bible says that I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Not because of what I've done or not done. Not because of some level of holiness or sinfulness that I have ascribed to. The Bible says that I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus simply because I stand in this place of forgiveness and grace because of what the blood of Jesus, of the finished work of the cross. So I'm going to say that again. I can declare that I am a blessed and righteous holy woman even if I don't do everything perfectly. Does that mean that that's an oxymoron or that is a fallacy? No, because the Bible says that I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus because of the finished work of Christ's love and sacrifice on the cross, okay? So because the word says that I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, then that means because that righteousness which was attributed to me because of my faith in Jesus Christ, that is what places me in a position to receive all the blessings of a righteous man, according to Psalm 1. Oh, sorry. Looked like our connection was off there for just a second. I'm going to say that again. So once you actually know the word of God about yourself, then you can actually claim those things as yours because you know that they are rightfully yours, and not because you've earned them, not because you've been good enough to secure them, but simply because the word says that you are, that I am, the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Because God attributed righteousness to you and to me because of our faith in his son, because of our faith in what the finished work of the cross that Jesus did. So that in itself causes God to look at me, or to look at you, those of us that have accepted him as Savior and Lord. When he looks at you and when he looks at me, he does not see our sinfulness. He does not see the wretchedness of our unrighteousness, but instead he sees that finished work of the cross. He sees that the forgiveness that he gifted to us, that he graced to us because of the obedience that his son did. And so he calls us righteous. He calls us holy. So the Bible says in Psalm 112 that the blessings of a righteous man, and I just explained what they all are, that is what's supposed to be in your house. And it's not because you earned it. It doesn't even matter, it doesn't even matter if you went a whole year without sinning. You could not rightfully earn the right to have the blessings of a righteous man or woman. It is a gift of grace from God to you, but you have to receive it knowing that you are deserving and worthy of it simply because he loves you. Okay, so I'm going to go to my last scripture, and it is Psalm chapter 1. Okay, so what I'm trying to awaken in you is this revelation that you are supposed to walk in an uninterrupted flow of God's love and joy and peace, his provision, his protection, his never-ending light and glory. Okay, the Bible says again, Isaiah chapter 26, he will keep him in perfect peace whose eyes is stayed on him. Okay, so I'm going to read Psalm 1, and I'm going to show you how sometimes we forfeit the peace of God. We forfeit the joy of God. We forfeit our provision and protection because we're trying to figure it out by ourselves. Okay, in fact, I had posted something on my Facebook timeline the other day that says, stop trying to think it out when you are supposed to faith it out. In other words, you're not going to be able to figure out everything, okay? So if you don't feel like you are walking in an overflow of God's provision, protection, and peace, and you have lost your hope that your life is supposed to look better, that your life is supposed to feel better, that you're supposed to have a certain amount of joy and peace on a consistent basis. If you have lost your hope in that, I'm trying to reawaken in you. I'm trying to give you a revelation of what it's supposed to look like, because there is always a yes in the heart of God towards you. Okay, so I'm going to read Psalm chapter 1. Okay, all right, so it says, blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of mockers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yield its fruit in season, whose leaf does not wither, and whatever he does prospers. I'm going to say that again. Blessed is the man or the woman who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the way of sinners, nor sit in the seat of mockers. But his or her delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, whose leaf does not wither, and whatever he does prospers. Okay. All right. So, again, in seasons of my Christian walk with the Lord, there have been times it's been hard for me to grasp the understanding that there is always a yes in God's heart towards me. Because of things that I experienced when I grew up, because of some erroneous teaching I received in the body of Christ, I believed that I had to at least press toward a certain amount of perfection or righteousness to be able to be considered worthy enough to receive certain things from God. But that's all jacked up thinking, because again, the Bible says that I am, that you are, the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, which means that God has attributed, that he has put on us, that he has labeled us as righteous because of the work that Jesus Christ did on the cross for us. So because of that, a righteous man is blessed coming and going. A righteous man is supposed to be underneath the, Psalm 91, he who dwells underneath the secret place of the Most High will dwell under the shadow of the Almighty. That is supposed to be our existence. Not because we earn it, not because we're worthy enough to receive it, but just because we are his kids. Okay? But what happens is that a lot of times when we don't have everything that we want, that we think we should have, and I'm not just talking about material things. I'm talking about joy. I'm talking about peace. I'm talking about love. I'm talking about, you know, whatever it might be. The problem is that sometimes we don't always go to God for it. We like try to figure it out for ourselves, okay? So the Bible says in Psalm 1 that, again, blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the way of sinners, nor sit in the seat of mockers. So my first question is, who are you getting your counsel and your advice from? When you have a situation in your life, a problem in your life, a something that is vexing you or perplexing you, what is the first thing that you do? Do you go to God, or do you call your best friend, or do you post something on social media and ask for everybody else's opinion? Or you know, all I'm saying is, do you seek out the counsel of the heavenly, or do you resort to your own human means, if that makes sense? The Bible says, blessed is the man who does not first turn to the ways of the world, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. I'm going to tell you right now, every answer that you need during your lifetime is in the Word of God. It is in the Word of God. And if you ask God, you're like, you know what, Lord, I don't even read my Bible enough to know where to go to find the right answers. All you have to do is say, Lord, I need your help. I need your guidance. I need your counsel. I need your direction. And I promise you, within 24 hours, there will be a thought that goes through your mind that will take you to the place that you need to be. Or maybe you will hear something. You'll hear somebody say something. It doesn't matter. If you will ask him, the Bible says that he left us the Holy Spirit as our comforter and as our guidance and as our director. Okay, so the Bible says that all we have to do is ask. Ask and keep asking and keep asking and keep asking until he alone answers. Don't resort to your own means. Don't resort to your own intellect. Don't resort to your own provisions. And don't resort to the advice and counsel of others, although I'm not saying it's a bad thing to get godly counsel, but I'm just saying, go to God first. Ask him to lead and guide you. The Bible says that he will keep him in perfect peace whose eyes is stayed on him. Okay, so the crux of what I wanted to share with you guys today is, as we are seeking to receive a restoration of hope, of grace, of mercy, of love in our life, as we are seeking to walk in the fullness of God's love and joy and peace every day of our lives, the first thing that I want you to know is, it is your right. It is not God's will for you to just exist from day to day and just make it from one day to the next day to the next day without slitting your wrists. That is not God's will for you. It is not God's will. It's just not. There is, remember what I said? The revelation that I wanted to bring to you guys today is that there is always, always, always a yes in God's heart towards you. Always. He loves you that much. And if you think that he doesn't love you that much, you are in error. There is always a yes in his heart towards you. He knows you. He sees you. He knows every intricate part of your personality and your psyche and your physical makeup and well-being. God knows you better than you know yourself. So the revelation that I want to bring to you today is that there is always a yes in God's heart towards you. Always. The Bible said he will keep him in perfect peace whose eyes is stayed on him. The Bible also says that he who dwells under the shelter, under the canopy, under the protection, under the provision, under the peace of the Almighty God, that person will rest in undisturbed places of peace underneath the shadow of the Almighty God. And I want to affirm to you today that that is your heavenly or godly birthright. That type of joy and peace is supposed to, you are supposed to walk in the fullness of it every moment of every day, okay? And so what I want you to remember is I at the beginning of this video, I recapped all of the scriptures that I introduced last week and the week before, and all of them talked about hope. So Hebrews 11:1, so this is my closing. Hebrews 11:1 says that now faith is the assurity, is the assurance, is being sure of what we hope for. And what we hope for is, remember, we're pressing towards it. We are leaning towards it. We are expectantly hopeful. We are joyfully hopeful that we will walk in this greater understanding of God's love and joy and peace in our life at all times. That is his will for you. That is his will for me. It is not his will for you to walk in a place of anxiety, fear, lack of provision, anger, frustration, lack of love, lack of being accepted or held or cherished. You know what? I kind of feel led to, I'm going to read something to you. This is private. I can't believe God's telling me I got to do this right now. Okay. I'm going to read to you some affirmations that the Lord gave me a couple of days ago. And as I wrote them down, like I knew them, and I thought, why am I writing this down? I think I wrote them down for this moment. So here we go. So this is how I'm going to close. Y'all ready? Okay. Instead of me speaking this in the affirmative about myself, I'm going to say this about you. You are loved, you are cherished, you are adored by your Heavenly Father. You are protected, you are lavishly provided for, you are forgiven completely by your Heavenly Father. You are comforted, you are healed, you are held and embraced, you are favored, you are honored, you are guided, and you are led by your Heavenly Father. So I began, I don't know why, this was like several days ago, I just wrote out these affirmations in my prayer journal. I'm like, why am I writing these down? Like, I already know that I am loved and cherished and adored by God. Like, I have a firm grasp. I know that I am one of his favorites. Actually, all of y'all are his favorite. I don't know how he does that. You know, as earthly parents, sometimes we do have a little bit of favoritism towards one child or another in whatever circumstance. But we are always, every single one of us, are God's favorite. Okay? So I wrote down that I am loved, I am cherished, I am adored. I want to remind you that you are loved and cherished and adored by God. I wrote that I am protected, I am provided for, I am completely forgiven, and so are you. I wrote down, I am healed, I am held, I am embraced, I am favored, I am honored, I am led, and I am guided by God himself. Now, that is the reality of what I am supposed to be walking in every day of my life. That is the reality of what you are supposed to be walking in every moment of every day of your life. And the only way that we will attain to that is if we are pressing towards it, is if we have a hopeful and joyful and expectation that is supposed to be the reality of my existence, okay? So I'm gonna read one more scripture to you, and then I'm going to be done, all right? Hang on just a second. Let me open. I told you, I feel like a disorganized preacher today. I have notes and notebooks all over in front of me. All right, hang on a second. So, all right. So again, I want to recap that hope looks like and sounds like Yes. Yes, he wants you to walk near him. Yes, he wants you to walk near enough to him that you will actually feel held and embraced and cherished and adored. Yes, he wants you to walk near him enough that you are in the right place at the right time, doing the right things, whatever those might be, to receive all of the provision and protection and peace that he has for you. Yes, he wants you to walk closely by his side so that you will be able to hear his guidance, his leading, his direction. I want to remind you in Psalm 23, it says that the Lord is our shepherd. In fact, that's where I'm going to close. Hang on a second. Let's go there. Psalm 23. Psalm 23 is the reality of what we're supposed to be living in every single day. The Lord is my and your shepherd. I shall not want. I shall have no need that goes unmet if I'm walking closely with him. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. It is his will that you walk, that you live in an undisturbed habitation of peace. He guides my paths with righteousness for his name's sake. He doesn't guide me for just so that, you know, I'll know where I'm going. He does so for his name's sake. So that when I say, you know what, God led and guided me in this particular situation, then he gets all the glory for it. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil because I'm walking right next to him. He's holding on to my hand. It doesn't matter what I go through in life, he's there with me. He never leaves me, never forsakes me. And I'm reminding that to you. And then the Ash says, I will fear no evil, for he is with me. His rod and his staff, they comfort me. He prepares a table for me, even in the presence of mine enemies. God prepares lavishly for me, even in situations where I feel like the enemy is attacking me. It says, surely his love and goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So, here is, last week I gave you an imagination exercise. I ask you to imagine three areas or three situations or three somethings in your life that you would really like for God to do something amazing in, where you feel like you're living in a certain amount of bankruptcy, so to speak, in those area, in that area or areas of your life. And I ask you to imagine what it would be like for God to do a great work or a great miracle or a great whatever in that area or areas. And I ask you to come to him with childlike faith. I reminded you that I was a little girl. They used to play with Barbies, and I used to imagine that I was Barbie and that I was married to Ken, and we lived in this princess fairyland. And so I want you to come to him with that kind of childlike faith. And here's what I want you to ask of God. I want you to ask him to remind you in every single way that he says yes to you. Because when you can get a revelation of how often, how much God wants to say yes to you, then your hopeful expectation will begin to rise. Your expectation that you will walk in a continual, perpetual habitation of his love, joy, and peace, that expectation will begin to get bigger and bigger and bigger. So all I want you to do is to ask God over the next week, ask God to show you, to reveal to you, to remind you in how many ways, in what specific ways, he has a yes in his heart towards you. And I think if you ask him that consistently, remember that to ask and keep asking, like bug him, like a toddler bugs their mom or dad. Bug him and ask him, say, Lord, show me where your heart says yes to me all the time, where maybe my eyes are blind to it. Show me where your heart is saying yes to me and where I'm maybe erroneously thinking that you're saying no when you actually want to say yes. Okay. So that is the revelation that I want to share with you guys today, that the revelation of hope is that it sounds like, it looks like, yes, that there is a yes in God's heart towards you at all times. And so the only way that you will have a hopeful expectation of God's goodness in your life is if you know what that goodness is supposed to look like. I just gave you a plethora of scriptures that remind you or that tell you what his goodness is supposed to look like. And all of that is supposed to be yours. So Father God, in Jesus' name, I pray, Lord God, that your word that I've shared today, I pray, Father God, that it would not fall on fallow ground, but that it would fall on fertile soil, Lord, of the hearts of men and women, and that it will spring forth and that it will produce a harvest in their life in Jesus' name. Father God, I ask in the name of Jesus that you would bring a revelation of hope to each and every person that's listening now or that will listen in the future. And Father God, that you will begin to show them specifically where your heart says yes to them today, where your heart says yes to them in every moment of their lives. In the name of Jesus, Father God, I ask that you would remind them that you are a good, good, good Father, and that it is your desire that they walk in a perpetual state of your love and your joy and your peace in their lives. In Jesus' name. Okay. I'm sorry, I was a little long-winded today. That was part one. Next week, I think I'll be sharing part two. And three favors. Number one, like, love, and share this video on your social media platforms. Number two, subscribe to my YouTube channel. You can go there and you can re-listen to the two introductory messages that I already shared. And sow a love offering or a seed of faith into my ministry today. Those links are in the description of this video. And I think that's it. I hope you guys have an amazing day. Bye.